And then, from the field of the future, a new king will come to save the world of the past.
Welcome back to the Comics Multiverse. My name is Chad, and this evening we are going to be talking about Arthur and the Knights of Justice. It's a graphic novel from Mad Cave, and it's based on the 90s cartoon. And we have Joe Corallo with us to discuss it. So let me bring him in and let's find out about him and the book. Good evening, Joe. How's it going?
It's going okay. How are you?
I'm here. So that's you know, you gotta set the bar for me.
There you go.
Set it kind of low. But I'm glad we're here, and glad, you know, after, you know, we've been talking about this, doing this for a while, and now that we're finally getting to do it, you know.
Yeah.
And it's all good. So before we get talking about the book, tell me a little bit about yourself and maybe about your history as a comic reader and as a creator.
Sure. You know, I really got into comics. I was about third grade. It was 93, 94, that area. I got into the Archie Sonic the Hedgehog comics with... what was it? I was at a Kmart with my mom, and the issue they had out at the time was number 28, which was a cover of Sonic having been taken over by Robotnik, and he beat up all the freedom fighters, and it's like Robotnik on like a monitor who's like cheering this turn of events. So that was when I really got into comics. I had my poor parents go around drive me to all these different shops on Long Island to go back issue diving. I got a subscription through Archie Comics, so they were getting delivered to the house, like, well, all that sort of stuff. That's what really cemented me as like a comics, like collector, like a reader, all of that. I went on to get more into Marvel once we got the Ultimate Spider-Man with Bendis and Runaways from Brian K. Vaughan. Got into DC through, you know, like Watchmen, Dark Knight Returns, things like that. I really started reading DC in floppies with the New 52, I mostly read them in like collections and things like that prior to that. But that got me like really into like the monthly habit of picking up DC floppies. I've been doing that, you know, with like Marvel titles prior to that. But that's really when I got in with DC. And just reading indie things. And that was also the New 52 was around the same time I was really trying to get into writing comics. I was self-publishing stuff in like 2011, 2012 or so. Got my first published piece in an anthology in 2015. That was illustrated by Sam Johns, who's gone on to write some comics at DC like Punchline. I edited my first anthology in 2017. By 2019, I had my first series picked up with a Vault, She Said Destroy with Liana Kangas, and you know, just kept plugging away from there.
Okay. And so let's talk about Arthur and the Knights of Justice. How about why don't we start off with like kind of a overview of the premise of the, because it was an, I'm correct that it was used to be a cartoon series.
Yes.
Right? Okay. It's a little past my time because I was in high school and kind of getting ready to go to college. So.
Oh yeah, no, absolutely. I was funny story. I don't know if I had put this together before in any other interview, but you know, now that you mention it, the show was also on 93-94. So I was watching that cartoon when it was like new coming out at the same time I was just getting into comics. So it's kind of interesting that it worked out that way. But yeah, it's two seasons. I believe they're both on Peacock. And I believe, I know at least recently, the first season was on Tubi. And that's a free streaming service. So if people want to check it out, they absolutely can that way. But yeah, it was a story of, you know, King Arthur and the knights get defeated by Morgana and her warlords, and Merlin has to find replacements. He goes to current day at the times of the 90s and gets a football team to replace King Arthur and the knights, unbeknownst to the people in Camelot, but you know, Morgana knows there's something up, obviously. There's the whole thing with the cartoon was there were these like keys and different things that you'd have to get to swap them out so you could restore one of the knights or King Arthur himself. That was really designed to keep the show going for a while. Like that aspect of it isn't in this book, for example, because that's a great device for a serialized show that you ideally want to get syndicated and you would love to have, you know, 100 or so episodes of. Mm-hmm. It doesn't work as well in a graphic novel format where you're trying to tell a full and complete story in 124 pages, which is four more pages than like originally we were, you know, going for like the 120, and then it, you know, just some back and forth, some things, the moments to flesh out. It was like, okay, so we got to 104. But much of the spirit of the original show is still there.
Okay. And so when you were kind of, what was kind of the inspiration for taking this, you know, 90s cartoon property and, you know, bringing it back for a graphic novel?
You know, I think a lot of this is, falls on Lauren, my editor, who's, editing a lot of the books over at the Maverick line. And she had wanted to do, Princess Guinevere and the Jewel Riders. And that was, it was a package deal sort of thing, you know, like, oh, and there's also this property. So it was a matter of finding someone who was familiar with the property, who had the excitement to want to be involved. And it came up in conversation at Baltimore Comic Con 2022. I was talking with Chaz, who's been an editor and letterer of mine at Mad Cave. And, you know, I was just like feeling things out because, you know, I was done with Dahlia in the Dark, my end at that point, even though the book wasn't out yet. I had finished writing it and, you know, just was like, oh, well, you know, if there's anything else, you know, like sort of coming up or this and that. And I'd happy to throw my hat in the ring. And he had asked me, oh, are you familiar maybe with like Princess Guinevere and the Jewel Riders? And without being prompted, I said, you know, I never watched that, but I did watch this show, King Arthur and the Knights of Justice. So, and he was also a fan of that show as a kid. So that was one of those things where it was like, oh, okay. And then finding out later, you know, they had that and we were, you know, talking about it. And it just sort of worked out that I was the person they wanted to go forward with on this. And I had a blast working on it, re-watching the old episodes, trying to, you know, figure out what to do with it. You know, working with Lauren, working with the license holder, because, you know, Lauren also had a, you know, an outline of more or less what her and the licensor were feeling out for this project. And I was, you know, able to like, you know, flesh that out and work on the story that people will be seeing in print on April 23rd or 24th, depending on if you're getting it at a bookstore or comic shop.
And so who, I mean, you've kind of talked about, you know, the premise, who are the main characters of the story? And did you kind of have one character that you kind of, you know, either at the beginning were like, ah, that's a, you know, that's a character I have to write, but by the end it's like, oh, that I've really grown attached to this character and, you know, wanted to do more with him? Or was there a character that, you know, that just you kind of latched onto?
Well, I mean, Arthur was really the anchor for it. A lot of this revolves around Arthur and people looking up to him to see the best decisions to make going forward as a team. I loved getting to write the villains. Morgana and Lord Viper are the primary villains in this. Every chance to write them was fantastic. There were characters where, you know, I don't want to spoil it too much, but, you know, I got to do a lot of things with like Gallop. And again, it was initially it was like, well, what do you do with all of these characters? Because there's 12 of the, you know, between King Arthur and the Knights, that's 12 characters alone. Then you have Guinevere and Merlin, who are also very prominent. You have Morgana and Lord Viper, who are also very prominent. And then you have all these other ancillary characters like Lady Elaine and you know, the two squires, Count Ainsworth, there's the Purple Horde shows up. Like there's all these other, there are multiple warlords that also, they don't have a ton of dialogue, but you also have to figure out what to do with some of those characters. So tons and tons of characters in this. It's a rather ensemble cast, but, you know, so you end up doing things where it's like, well, Arthur's sort of like the lead, and then Lance and Breeze are like the second most like sort of important in the book. So just trying to focus on that and be like, okay, well, these are the characters leading it, and then these other ones are sort of you know, reacting to either Arthur or Lance or Breeze in these situations. But figuring out something to do with Gallop, that was fun for me. I'm really glad I got to do it. I hope people enjoy that, because that he was a character where it was like, okay, well, you know, just going through this whole list of like, well, what am I going to do with this, that, and the other? So I'm excited for people to check out that and see what we do with some of those characters. You know, Lug as well. Lug's a little different than he was in the show, because in the show, He was like the equipment's manager, but we put him on the team in this. So there's a little bit of a slightly different dynamic there. I really loved the sort of things I was able to do with Guinevere. That was a lot of fun. Obviously, Merlin is a joy. Getting to kind of develop a little bit more on, you know, Darren is a character, that kind of, you know, that was another one of those things where, you know, you're writing and you're filling things out and you're getting them to do certain things. And then you're like, oh, I guess I did give like Darren like more than I maybe initially thought, was going to work out in this, and, was able to sort of play on this like Brick and Wally dynamic over the course of the book that I also enjoyed. So yeah, there's a lot there. I think for people, again, it's primarily probably Arthur, Lance, and Breeze, but there's a lot more that these other characters get to do that we get to explore in this.
And tell me a little bit about the rest of the creative team, your artist and, you know, the other people that you work with, and kind of the process you guys went through to bring this to the page.
Well, I mean, luckily, one of the fun things here was that we were all more or less on the same page through all of it. I would get the script over to Lauren. Lauren would get it over to the licensor. Well, she would have her notes, you know, to be like, okay, let's get this all squared away. Send the most polished version of this as possible. To the licensor, and then, you know, the licensor would have any of their notes, and honestly, they've been super easy to work with. There's been, I'm sure there are people out there who have their stories about like maybe like a licensor says like something's good and then it gets all written and then they're like, whoa, wait a minute, there was a miscommunication, we said it was okay to do this with this character, but you kind of went a different direction that we're not comfortable with or this and that, but there was none of that. And then, you know, Gaia Cardinelli was who did all the art. So the line work and the colors. So there was no miscommunication there or anything there. It was all level in that. Well, you know, it's not like Gaia's going to have any notes up for the colorist. So that streamlined it a bit too. So, you know, it was, we do layouts, inks, colors, and then Chaz was the letter on that. And yeah, I mean, it was pretty, a pretty well-oiled machine. Honestly, very little in terms of notes or big changes in the line work. That really didn't happen. Like the vision was pretty concise. Chaz did a great job lettering. I didn't have any notes. I don't think Lauren really did either in terms of, you know, font structure and this and that. So I mean, it was really, you know, well-oiled machine. And I think, I mean, we'll see what happens, but I think that shows in the page.
Yeah. Now, I know it's a complete graphic novel. It's, you know, depending on how this, you know, does, is there a possibility for further adventures?
We definitely leave it open in the sense of you could potentially do more if people buy this and there's interest from the licensor. This is a complete story, but there's plenty of other things you could do. This is like Arthurian legend. There are countless other aspects to it that haven't gotten, you know, touched on in this book. There's only so much you can do in one, you know, 124 page graphic novel story. So, I mean, it would be great to see them do more. I'd certainly welcome the opportunity if they not only wanted to do more, but asked me to do it as well. But no, I think there's a lot left to do if people want, but you are getting a full and complete story of this adventure that these kids are kind of there's like foisted upon them that they now have to figure out how they're going to deal with suddenly being in Camelot and having to, you know, fight off one of the most notorious like warlocks of fiction. So
now, besides, you know, kind of probably refreshing yourself with the animated series, did you have to do any, you know, research into Arthurian legend or anything like that?
You know, I also do love Arthurian legend beyond this. Excalibur is a favorite movie of mine. The John Borman film from the early 80s with, Patrick Stewart, Liam Neeson, those guys. That fantastic film. Helen Mirren, obviously, as Morgana, crazy. I do own a copy. I actually have it here of Le Morte de Arthur. It's a nice thick book here. So, you know, refresh myself on a lot of the lore here as well. None of that was necessary. No one was like, well, if you're going to do this, you have to like get these things. But I do like knowing what I'm doing when I can. Right. And I enjoy Arthurian myth and legends. So, you know, figured why not? And, you know, you might see some references to other elements of Arthurian myth that are not featured in the show. I also read around the time I was offered the gig, the Grant Morrison novel Luda, which also has a lot of Arthurian myth in it. So, you know, pulling some from that as well. So I figure it can't hurt to write a comic that has some influence from Grant Morrison in there.
I hear he's up and comer, but you know. So, would you like to play five questions?
I'm sure I can do five questions.
Okay. So, question number one: five writers who influence, you know, your writing, be it, you know, with, well, we've already talked about, you know, the influences for this project.
Yeah.
But, you know, as a writer in general, you know, who influences your, you?
Sure. I mean, you know, there's so many, but I would say definitely Rachel Pollack. She was a, you know, friend and mentor of mine for years. Definitely influences what I do. I would say James Robinson in particular, his work on Starman is very influential for me. I think his just sort of understanding and just having like his ability to like weave in and out of the continuity and just his the way he could tell such a large scale story was really impressive to me. And you know, I hope more people keep going back and checking that out now that it's in print in the compendiums. Okay, so that's two. Okay. I would say Howard Cruise is someone else was a major influence on me. Someone I communicated with and got to be friends with. Was definitely someone whose work inspired me. Let's see. God, it's just All right, so that's three. I can do this. Jeff Lemire is a big one for me. I really fell in love with Sweet Tooth. I love when he writes and draws his own material.
Yep.
I think
my favorite thing of his is Underwater Welder.
Yes, I love Underwater Welder. I love Trillium. I'm really enjoying Fish Flies. I loved the one, what was it, Maze? The Dark Horse one.
Yeah. Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
But yeah, that one was really good. Yeah, and then, you know, the last one I'll say, just I got this here. It's so Fabian Velman did this. Was a writer, did some French books like Beautiful Darkness. Uh-huh. It's one of my all-time favorite. Beautiful Darkness, Satania. Those are two incredible books. There's another one he did, Something Immortal, that was through, I think it was Archaea before it was, you know, bought out by Boom. Actually, I might have this over here too, so I'm gonna double check. But all right, I know it's here somewhere, but you know, but yeah, either way, really good stuff. The French do some incredible work, you know, and yeah, I wish more people would talk about and read, you know, his stuff, because it's so creative. You know, I can't praise it enough.
Okay. So question two, since, you know, the Arthur and the Knights of Justice are based off the cartoon, what were your top cartoons growing up or currently? Because you're never too old for cartoons.
Oh, sure. I mean, if we're cheating and saying currently, I've been on top of and really enjoying, you know, X-Men 97. Mm-hmm. But I mean, in the past, I would say things like, you know, obviously Batman the Animated Series. It's so cliche to say that, but also, how can you not? I really enjoyed, and I still enjoy and go back to like the Garfield and Friends and the Garfield specials. I actually own a cell from the Christmas special.
Oh, nice.
It's Garfield and Grandma Arbuckle. It's really nice. But I you know, love that stuff. Rocko's Modern Life was big for me. I really love that show. The Twisted Tales of Felix the Cat, if people haven't checked that out. I feel like that's kind of a memory hold, but it's actually really a lot of fun. Also, the Felix the Cat animated movie. Love that. Rock and Rule is another animated movie I really love. I'm a big fan of animated movies. The original Snow Queen, the it's like from 1958, I want to say, as a Soviet era Russian film. It's what got it's what inspired Miyazaki to want to do animation. Spirited Away is definitely up there for me. I'm really looking forward to Mars Express, which is out in theaters in the U.S. next month. It is a neo-noir sci-fi French animated film. It looks gorgeous.
I have to look for it.
Yeah, no. And then, what was it? René Deluxe. He did a bunch of amazing French animated films, including Fantastic Planet. He did it with Mobius, did the design work on it. I can look this up in a second. It's Time Masters, that's it. It's Time Masters. And also Gandahar, which is another film I really love from him, French animated. The English version script was written by Isaac Asimov. It was one of the last things he wrote before he passed.
Okay.
So, but yeah, I could go on and on about animation from different parts of the world and, you know, whatever for forever. So, but, so that's probably enough for now. There are so many. I mean, also the Transformers movie from like from the 80s was also like that. That's great. I mean, it's so good. I love that one.
I like how I just the. On the DVD, I have one of the chapters is curse word.
Where amazing.
But okay, so I think we're on question number three. On who would be the four comic creators that you would put on your personal Mount Rushmore?
Well. It's really tough. If you're gonna pick four, Matt Baker's up there. I would put Matt Baker on there. I think he did a lot to sort of reinvigorate the golden age of comics, the way he drew women, in particular at the time. But you know. Drawing what is arguably the first graphic novel with It Rhymes with Lust, which I believe I also have in arm's length from me. It Rhymes with Lust, really important. If people haven't read it, you need to read it. Consider one of the first graphic novels. And it's written, at least co-written by Arnold Drake, who is an incredible force as well. I would say... All right, so that's one. I feel like it's hard, like, I think I would have to put George Perez.
Okay.
George Perez. It's a tough one. I mean, there's so many pick from. Yeah. It's impossible. But I mean, him and John Byrne were the 80s, you know, and while I do love a lot of what John Byrne did, you could probably make the argument the other way, but like the fact that George and Marv went to DC and reinvigorated new Teen Titan with new Teen Titans, basically somehow managed to create a book that was almost up there with X-Men in terms of sale and excitement. And that they created all of these new characters for it that are like, when people think of the Teen Titans now, that's the team they still think of. Mm-hmm. They inspired that team, that cartoon, both versions are from the work that the two of them did together. It's crazy. And you know, I mean, Marv is a great talent himself, but, you know, George then going on and reinvigorating Wonder Woman in a way that people, you know, I don't think thought was possible at the time, but like, you know, completely redefined that character. And just the countless other work he did, just wonderful. And the revamping Avengers with Kurt Busiek, like, uh-huh. Crazy. Yeah. Stuff. I would say so that's two. Scott McCloud, I'm gonna put his third. Not just understanding comics, but I mean, Zot is an incredible book, just incredible. I think it's such an important work that doesn't get talked about enough. Destroy, that one shot he did, which just like demolishes the idea of these like big comic you know, fights and stuff like that. I mean, Destroy is unbelievably good. I love that book. It's so funny and looks amazing. The Sculptor. Again, like he is just incredible. And I guess if I was going to go with, okay, so that's three. I feel like, all right, so if I'm going to go for one more, three, and they were all artists or writer artists, so I'll go for a writer this time and say Chris Claremont, because I do not know what American comics look like if Claremont didn't make the X-Men the success it turned into. Mm-hmm. I don't think any of us know. Like what he was able to do with that book, it changed the industry forever. And I mean, obviously the artists were all important. He got to work with some incredible artists, but the fact that he was able to do that and continue it with the artist changes, and that it still was like hitting new highs over and over, you know, Cockrum, Byrne, Paul Smith, JRJR, Silvestri, Jim Lee, it's hard to not put him on a Mount Rushmore, particularly of like American comics. There are so few people that I think you could say, well, if they weren't in this industry, I truly don't know where it would have gone, and he's absolutely one of them.
Gotcha. I think that's a great list. And it's always just fun to see what, you know, everybody's personal list is.
Absolutely.
And, you know, tomorrow it could be different for you. And that's another great thing about the whole. Let's see. Let's say Marvel or DC or it came to you and said you can work on any character you want with any artist you want. Who would you choose? Both the character and maybe the artist.
Oh, geez. I mean, one thing that I think would be a lot of fun would be to do Legion of Superheroes. I'm a big fan of them. To be able to do them with like someone like V. Ken Marion, who's an up-and-coming artist to an extent. I mean, he's gotten to do a bunch of stuff at like DC over the years. But I met him, God, it would have been 2012. I think we were both in one of those like networking with writers and artists kind of things at a New York Comic Con. And, we've kept in touch on and off since then. But would love a chance to work with him on something, and I think Legion of Superheroes would be a fantastic thing to do together there. With something like, you know, Marvel, I was always more into some of like the periphery X titles, like X Factor. I think Peter David's X Factor is a high watermark for me. So to be able to do something like that, like an X-Factor type book, X-Factor Investigations type thing, and to get to work with an artist like Danny Luckert, who's one of the first artists I worked with in self-publishing and has gone on to do a bunch of things at Red 5, some things at Boom. He just collaborated with Karina Beckow on a book. And before that, he was doing... Red Mother at Boom. So like he is a rising star as well. It'd be a great, I think, opportunity to be able to work with him on something. And I think something like X Factor would be a good fit.
Okay. And so as we kind of wrap up here, time to give a final summary or pitch for the book and where people can find you on social media if you're there.
Well, with the book, I will say, again, it's out very soon, April 23rd, 24th. I will be at C2E2 signing. If people are at the show, I believe Sunday, there's going to be a panel for Maverick books. And then I'll be signing at the Mad Cave booth after that. I'll be at Fourth World Comics at some point during the day for Free Comic Book Day signing as well. People can also catch me at like Heroes Con. I'll be there. That's coming up. And Cradle Con on Long Island in May. With the book, it's this is my YA debut. I I'm really proud of the work we all did on it. Everyone involved. I made sure there was a lot of action. We really push it in terms of the action and violence and things while still, you know, making sure that it's appropriate for YA audience. I love to write those villains and over the top Merlin and Morgana back and forth, all that stuff. I really hope people, give this a shot, check it out. I'm really proud with how it came out. And you can find me on Twitter and Blue Sky at Joe Corallo, JoeCorallo, or on Instagram at Corallo Joe.
Okay. Well, I'm sorry. Now I figured out I screwed up your name in the intro.
Oh, you're fine. No worries.
All right. Well, it was a pleasure to have you on and find out about the book, and best of luck when it goes on sale. And as you mentioned, if people want to kind of get a taste for what to expect from the book, the cartoons are available. They have Peacock, and I think you said it's maybe on Tubi also.
Yeah.
So, but it was great chatting with you and learning more about the book. And if you have something, in the future that you would like to come on and talk about, I'd love to have you back.
Well, thank you. No, I'd love to be back.
All right, well, have a great evening, and best of luck with the book. And, we love Mad Cave here, and they have some great stuff, and everybody needs to check this out.
No, absolutely. I hope everyone checks out Princess Guinevere and the Jewel Riders as well, which comes out the following month.
Okay, cool. Definitely we'll have to do that, too. All right, yep. Have a good evening.
Great, thanks.